drums roll out, and the trumpets call, while the people shout, strike up the band, hear the cymbals ring, calling one and all to the marshal swing, strike up the band. There is work to be done, to be done. There's a prize to be won, to be won. Come, you son of a gun, of a gun, take your stand. Band in the land, like the play bugle call like you never heard before. Taka ta 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 ta. That's just the bestest band. What am my little honey lamb? Come on along, come on along, and let me take you by the hand.
Trumpets call,
while the people shout,
strike up the band,
hear
the cymbals ring, calling one and all, while the saxes swing, strike up the band.
And there is work to be done, to be done, there are songs to be sung, to be sung. You son of a gun, here's a plan, the plan, fall in line, yeah, boy.
St. Louis, Missouri.
You bet.
And for those of you who may not know, the Gas House Gang was the nickname of the St. Louis baseball Cardinals back in the 1930s. Any Cardinal fans in this part
Maybe
of the country?
Thank you.
They put them way up in the balcony. Yeah,
more than up in the balcony.
Can we get a ride home tomorrow?
It's a long
But, well, you know, the Cardinals got that nickname because of the rough and fiery style of play that they had, and we felt like that kind of suited this quartet since we sing rough and been fired from just about every job we ever had.
What kind of thing is that for you to say?
But, well, I got to say, before we go any further, though, I'm really happy to be here. I've been having a problem. I've been dealing with a cold for the last couple weeks, and I really wasn't sure if I was going to be able to sing tonight or not, but it's okay. I've got it taken care of. What I did was, for the last week, I've been eating 2 pounds of prunes every day.
Sure, I've never heard that.
It's disgusting. I can't even
that's,
look.
That's gross.
Did that really cure your cold? 2 pounds of prunes?
Well, not really, but I sure think twice before I cough.
The whole bridge, everybody down the
got a mule, her name is Sal. 15 years on the Erie Canal.
She's a good old worker, she's a good old pal.
15 years on the Erie Canal. We've hauled some barges in our day, filled with lumber, coal, and hay.
And
every inch of the way we know, from Albany. Everybody down Low Bridge, 'cause we're coming.
into a town, and you'll always know your neighbor, you'll always know your pal, if you've ever navigated on the Erie Canal.
Oh, oh bridge, everybody down,
you'd better get along the locale, 15 miles on the Erie Canal, cause you bet your life I never part with Sal. 15 miles on the Erie Canal, get up there, Sal, here comes a lock. We'll make Rome about 6 o'clock. Just one more trip and then we'll go right back home to Buffalo.
Oh, where would I be if I lost my pal?
Yeah, 15 years on the Erie Canal.
Well, I'd like to see a mule as good as Sal.
Yeah, 15 years on the Erie Canal.
A friend of mine once got her sore. Now he's got a broken jaw, cause she let fly with an iron toe,
yeah,
and kicked him into Buffalo.
You'll soon hear him sing all about my gal, 15 years on the Erie Canal. It's a darn fine ditty about my darn fool Sal, 15 years on the Canal.
Oh, any band will play it soon.
Darn fool words
and darn fool tune.
You'll hear it sung everywhere you go, from Mexico to Buffalo. Town. If you're looking for some trouble, better stay away, old pal. She's the meanest fighting donkey on the Erie Canal. The meanest fighting donkey on the Erie Canal. So don't you come and navigating too close on the Erie Canal. On the Erie Canal.
Many of you know that Kip's not really the original tenor in our quartet. We traded around a couple of years ago, and well, ever since Kip came into the quartet, seems like things have gone a little differently. Seems like he's always got to outdo you. He's got to be one better than you and everybody else. If that's not bad enough, now these guys are starting to do the same darn thing.
My old man's a sailor, now what do you think about that? He wears a sailor's collar, and he wears a sailor's hat. He wears a sailor's raincoat, and he wears a sailor's shoes. Every Saturday evening, he reads the sailor news. And someday, if I can, I'm gonna be a sailor the same as my old man. Thank you.
Well, my old man's an anthropologist.
Now, what do you think about that? He wears an anthropologist collar with an anthropologist hat. He wears an anthropologist raincoat and anthropologist shoes. Every Saturday evening, he meets anthropologist news. And someday, if I can, I'm gonna be an anthropologist the same as my old man.
Well, my old man's a refrigerator repairman. What do you think about that? He wears a refrigerator repairman's collar, wears a refrigerator repairman's hat. He wears a refrigerator raincoat, he wears a refrigerator repairman's shoes. Every Saturday evening, he reads Penthouse magazine.
He's an anthropologist. This is amazing. Kick us out of here.
Oh, wow. And someday, if I can,
I'm gonna be a refrigerator repairman, same as my old man.
Sorry.
Well, my old man's a cotton picking, finger licking, chicken plucker. What do you think about that? Y'all can sing along here if you want to. He wears a cotton picking finger licking chicken flicker's collar, wears a cotton picking finger licking chicken flicker's head. He wears a cotton picking finger licking chicken flicker's ring, wears a cotton picking finger licking chicken flicker's shoes. Every Saturday evening, he reads the cotton picking finger licking chicken flicker's news. And someday, if I can, I'm gonna be a cotton picking finger licking chicken plucker.
Woo!
The same as my old man.
Yeah.
The same as my old sailing father's refrigerator repairman, cotton picking finger licking chicken plucking man. My old.
For the next song we'd like to do, it was written and recorded back in 1946 by a gentleman named Merle Travis. A couple years later, a friend of his re-recorded and released the song, and it became an overnight sensation. It sold over 20 million copies, and it sent the young country singer who performed it the second time into instant stardom. Because of that, he had record contracts, television appearances like on the I Love Lucy show, and he also had his own television variety show for a short period of time called The Ford Hour. So for our next song, we'd like to feature our bass gem on the song that kind of kicked it all off for Tennessee Ernie Ford, 16 Tons.
Some people say a man is made out of mud. A poor man's made of muscle and blood. Muscle and blood, skin and bone. A mind that's weak and a back that's strong. Yeah, those 16 tons, and what do you get? Another day older and a deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, 'cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the the company store. I was born one morning when the sun didn't shine. I picked up my shovel and I walked to the mine. I loaded 16 tons, but number 9 coal, and the straw boss said, well, bless my soul, you load 16 tons, and what do you get? Another day over and a deeper in debt. It's laying Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store. I was born one morning, it was drizzling rain, a fighting land trouble. If you see me coming,
step aside.
A lot of men didn't, and a lot of men died. One fist of iron, the other of steel. And if the right one don't get you, then the left one will. You load 16 times. And what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store.
Summer day, flash those big bright eyes my way, and oh, I wanted you forevermore.
Now, baby, I'm not one that gets around. I swear my feet stuck to the ground, and though I never did meet you before,
I said, hello, Mary Lou.
Goodbye, heart.
Goodbye, heart.
I said, sweet Mary Lou, I'm so in love with you. I'm in love with Mary
Lou. I knew Mary Lou.
Never part, so hello, Mary Lou. Goodbye, heart, goodbye, heart.
Saw your lips, I heard your voice. Believe me, I just had no choice. Wild horses couldn't make me stay away. Thought about a moonlit night, arms about you good and tight. That's all I need to see for me to say.
Hey, hello, Mary Lou. Goodbye, heart,
goodbye, heart.
I said, sweet Mary Lou, I'm so in love with you. I'm in love with Mary
Lou. I knew Mary Lou.
We'd never part.
We'd never part. So hello, Mary Lou. Goodbye, heart. Goodbye, heart.
Hello, Mary Lou. I'm in love with you.
Yes, hello, Mary Lou.
Goodbye, heart.
Right from the start, I said hello.
Thank you. Okay. Yeah, good luck. Yeah, okay. Good. Thank you. As Rick mentioned earlier, I am not the original tenor of the quartet. It was a gentleman named Joe Fink, who was a great guy, and they miss him terribly. They always tell me every rehearsal they come. So anyway, I joined them 5 years ago, and they let me in on their policy about whatever they would do. Anytime they would go to a city they hadn't been to before, they would rent a car and go driving around and see the sights of the city. Well, I thought that was a great plan. You know, it's a great way to see the country. So when I first joined them, it was like the second week I was with them. 5 years ago, we had a chance to go to Arizona. None of us had ever been there before, so we thought this would be great. So we get there, we rent a car, we were driving around, looking at the sights, and we came upon this sign that said Indian Reservation ahead 20 miles. None of us had ever seen that before, you know, so we thought it was worth it. So we were driving on down, and we came upon this little shack. And on the door of the shack was a sign that said, inside is the oldest Indian in the world, with the best memory in the world. Come in and talk to him for only a dollar a person. We thought that was worth it, so we jumped out of the car, paid our money, walked inside, and sure enough, there was this really old guy sitting, appropriately enough, Indian style, in the middle of this big rug in this shack. So we're sitting in there talking with him, and things are going pretty good. And Rick, I guess, is kind of the skeptical one of the quartet. You know, he kind of stops the conversation. He says, this is ridiculous. I just don't buy this whole thing. I mean, it's obvious that you're old, okay? We can see that. But this whole memory thing, I just don't buy it. I'm sorry. I just don't buy it. And if you have the best memory in the world, what did you have for breakfast the morning of June 30th, 1941? And the Indian, without hesitation, looked right at Rick and said, eggs. I know, it affected me the same way. I just could not believe it. Blew me away. So we finished talking with him, we went back, we sang on the show, we flew home, and we really didn't think too much else about it until last weekend we had a chance to go to Arizona again. And while we were there, Jim said, well, let's go see if this guy is, you know, still alive, because he must have been 150 when we were there before. So we rented a car, we were driving around, looking at the sights. We came upon the same sign that said Indian Reservation ahead 20 miles. So we're driving on down the road, we're getting excited, you know, we come up and there's the same shack. And on the door of the shack is a sign that says, inside is the oldest Indian in the world with the best memory in the world. Come in and talk to him for only $5 a person. That's it. It's inflation, you always gotta pay more. So we paid our money, we walked inside, and sure enough, there is the same guy sitting Indian style in the middle of the same rug. We just could not believe it. And Rob, I guess, was kind of inspired by the moment or something, walks up to the Indian and says, how? And the Indian looked right at Rob and said, scrambled. You can believe that.
Still the wind blows goes through the trees. Street lights, they still shine bright. Most things are the same, the same.
But I miss my dad tonight. I walked by a Salvation Army store. Saw a hat like my daddy would do. Put it on and fix the trying to be like him.
No matter how hard I try, no matter how many years go by, no matter how many tears I cry, I still can't say goodbye.
That was my brother. Thank you. Listen, we're going to do one more song for you, but before we do, I want to set this up a little, and I also want to tell you that we've got tapes and CDs for sale, after the show, we'll be back in the lobby back there just hawking those suckers away, so if anybody would like to... I want to set this next song up for you just a little bit. I'm a music student back in St. Louis, where we're all from, and I go to one of these schools. It's kind of one of these, you know, snobby kind of schools. They kind of look down their noses, you know, at barber shop music. I'm sure you can imagine. They're all into Beethoven and Bach and Chopin and that crown. And anyway, I've run into so much trouble with that I came up with a really good idea. I thought maybe if our quartet could learn a classical number, you know, that maybe we could sing it for my professors, you know, and they'd be a little bit more impressed with what we do, and they wouldn't keep failing me on my exams all the time. And all the guys thought that'd be a good idea. So we got a bunch of classical albums out and started listening to a lot of classical music and found one that we really, really liked. It's a little Mozart. Diddy. By the name of Eine Kleine Nachtmusik. Very juicy piece of music, as you can see. Anyway, we thought that'd be a good number, you know, sort of bouncy, kind of a good melody, easy to dance to, you know. And then we discovered one little problem. No words. To that, baby, and when you sing, you know, acapella, when you sing without instruments like we do, you find the words come in awfully handy, but we were undaunted by this fact. We were not daunted. Nay, nay, daunted not were we. We asked a good friend of ours by the name of Neil Fredrickson if, you know, maybe he could write some words to this tune. And sure enough, he came back a couple weeks later having written the words and the lyrics to the song that you're about to hear us. Anyway, he did a really clever thing, by the way, in writing the words to this Eine kleine Nachtmusik. I just love saying that word, boy. Why don't you all say that from where you are? He tells a story of a completely different Mozart work, a little Mozart opera by the name of The Magic Flute. Thank you very much. We would like to sing now, as our final number for this evening, the Eine kleine, you know the rest, telling the story of The Magic Flute. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with the opera, The Magic Flute, let me tell you all about it right now. It's all about this magic flute. Thank you very much.
If in tunes it's something hot you seek, try some Eine kleine Nachtmusik.
Mozart, when he was just a child, was really kind of wild. He was a prodigy, and he was always thinking of a tune or rhyme, but an opera or symphony.
Wolfgang, was he rare? None compared. Had no tear to
So he wrote so many notes that some composers who were average thought him dumb. But he didn't mind, because they weren't unkind. They just could not see that he was more than they could be. Now everyone see,
like in his Opus 53 or in the Hofner Symphony.
Oh,
golly gee.
Here is sort of how one opera goes. Even if you don't like opera,
if you hate it, it's
the story of the famous magic flute. And you can see if you like it,
then see how you would rate it. First there's a prince who's being chased by a great big snake who's scared off by ladies who are singing.
One of the things is the alto and the other.
Second hand, and then this guy with a birdcage enters, and he's really looking strange.
He's all dressed up with feathers, he sings about his love life. The prince gives him a listen, but really couldn't care less.
And then they all go up together in a
circle. And then they meet with a bunch of good guys who give them a magic flute.
Which wards off evil if you get the knack,
and will protect you if you play it
if
right.
If you're playing it in tune.
Now we're ready for the real good part. There's a queen who's evil through and through, and a prince says too good to be true.
The plot begins to thicken.
The queen is planning something.
The prince, he loves the princess.
The queen sings lots of high notes.
Go.
Come on.
Time's wasted. Oh, man, they're all staring at me. I can't do this.
The birdman is a chicken.
The queen rounds up her henchmen.
The prince is so courageous.
Will evil ever triumph?
The characters are in it.
And now it gets confusing.
There's priests and slaves and others.
And then this Moorish bad guy.
And now nobody knows what's going on.
Including us, we're going crazy, but then that's the way it goes.
It shows that opera can be fun, but the ending's only just begun.
Doubt prince endures a lot of trials that go for miles and miles, but don't you worry, cuz he's got the flute.
When he plays it good like he should, all is well, especially to the orchestra.
Then the queen and all the baddies, they get flustered because they know they'll never win. If they try again, for the wings of sin is the fate of evil tea. If only they could see how happy they would be, the pens and pencils faithfully.
Now we're ready for the end at last.
Please get on with it.
It seems that good and evil have a shootout, all complete with thunder and lightning
and stuff.
The evil queen goes wacko, the prince is always steadfast. The queen can't seem to beat him,
here he did play.
And he is on the side of just food and trouble.
Righteous comes the queen and all of the bad guys vanquished, and our heroes find success.
Now that the danger's over, the prince and princess marry.
The birdman
finds a girlfriend, and everybody's happy.
But then we find that the whole thing's allegory. Mozart having fun,
just like he wrote him when he was a lad.
Because of all the talent that he had, he got it from his dad.
Try some Mozart if you're down.
Far and wide he is renowned.
So put some on your stereo.
Today
there are so many things that you can choose to play.
They're all arranged in
numbers, and they start with K.
Get a record or CD.
Hey, so get a record or CD.
Right away.